What if I told you the biggest military hack in U.S. history was done by a man searching for aliens from his bedroom? The towers had fallen. America was reeling. And then a message flickered across military computer screens that would send shockwaves through the Pentagon. Your defenses are pathetic. I've been everywhere. What happened next would become the largest military cyber breach in U.S. history, all executed by one man. From his bedroom, in London, February 2001. While America slept, Gary McKinnon was wide awake. His fingers danced across a secondhand keyboard, sliding through digital backdoors like a phantom in the machine. NASA, the Pentagon, naval weapon systems, Air Force networks. One by one, they fell. But Gary wasn't after state secrets or classified weapons data. He was hunting for something far more extraordinary. Evidence that we are not alone. For 13 months, Gary roamed freely through America's most sensitive networks. He left calling cards. Digital graffiti sprayed across administrator desktops. "Your foreign policy breeds terror," he typed into one system. "I will continue disrupting at the highest levels." Here's the kicker. Gary never used sophisticated hacking tools. No viruses, no malware. He simply knocked on digital doors, and they opened. Military networks protected by passwords like password and admin. Half the systems had no passwords at all. It was like breaking into Fort Knox and finding they'd left the keys in the ignition. March 19, 2002. London. The knock came at dawn. British cybercrime specialists stood at Gary's door, armed with arrest warrants and American fury. The man they found was nothing like the digital terrorist they'd imagined. Thin, pale, 36 years old, still living with his mother. Gary McKinnon had just become the most wanted hacker in the world. From childhood, Gary lived in his own universe. While other kids played football, he stared at the stars, asking his mother if Noah's Ark might have been a spaceship. His Scottish accent made him a target at school. His brilliant mind made him an outcast. But in the digital realm, Gary found his sanctuary. Logic, order, systems that made sense when the real world didn't. At his computer job, colleagues dismissed his skills as unremarkable. The Pentagon would soon disagree. What drove Gary wasn't money or malice. It was obsession. He believed the U.S. government possessed recovered alien spacecraft, hidden from the world, studied in secret. Through military networks, he hunted for proof. Files labeled non-terrestrial officers, photographs of otherworldly craft. But what Gary claims he saw next would haunt him forever. A photograph, crystal clear. A craft unlike anything in any military handbook. Cigar-shaped, otherworldly. As he stared at the impossible image, one thought echoed, "This changes everything." Then the screen went black. Connection severed. Evidence gone. The hunt was over. For 3 years, Gary thought he was safe. The British authorities seemed uninterested. No classified data had been stolen. Maybe it would all blow over. Then June 7, 2005 arrived like a thunderclap. American prosecutors wanted blood. 60 years in federal prison. The biggest military hack in history, they called it. Gary's mother, Janice, felt her world collapse. "Extradite?" she whispered. "Terror doesn't begin to describe what I felt." The timing was devastating. Gary's hacks occurred in 2001-2002, when Britain required evidence for extradition. But in 2003, Tony Blair's government signed a new treaty. No evidence needed. America's word was enough. They applied it retroactively to Gary's case. One signature from the Home Secretary, and Gary would disappear into the American justice system. Guantanamo loomed in his nightmares. Janice McKinnon refused to surrender her son. She became a media strategist, legal researcher, and political activist overnight. Television interviews, newspaper campaigns, letters to every politician who would listen. CNN called him America's most wanted hacker. But to UFO enthusiasts worldwide, Gary McKinnon became something else entirely, a digital martyr. During a major TV interview, something unexpected happened. Viewers began calling Gary's lawyers with the same observation. This man has Asperger's syndrome. Everything clicked into place. The social isolation. The literal interpretation of language. The obsessive quest for truth. In 2008, psychiatrists confirmed what viewers had seen. Gary wasn't a terrorist. He was autistic. Gary's interview revealed America's dirty secret. Military networks with no passwords. Administrative accounts left wide open. I never had to break in, Gary explained. It was like they left the doors unlocked. The Pentagon's response? Embarrassed rage. Gary hadn't just exposed their UFO secrets. He'd exposed their incompetence, and that was unforgivable. Janice's campaign gained momentum. David Gilmour of Pink Floyd joined the cause. Sting and his wife Trudy Styler added their voices. Boris Johnson, then London's mayor, wrote, "Gary believes in little green men, but that doesn't make him a terrorist." Even future Prime Minister David Cameron promised compassion. But America wanted justice, and America rarely compromises. As legal battles raged, Gary deteriorated. The man who once created music couldn't touch an instrument. He stopped eating, stopped sleeping. Janice watched her son disappear into depression and anxiety. Multiple psychiatrists reached the same conclusion. Extradition could trigger suicide. But would that be enough to save him? David Cameron became prime minister. Home Secretary Theresa May paused Gary's extradition to review medical evidence. At a joint press conference with President Obama, Cameron carefully suggested an appropriate solution might be found. Obama's response was measured, but firm. The crime was serious. Justice must be served. Janice allowed herself to hope. Dr. Elon Vermes, endorsed by both the Home Office and the National Autistic Society, conducted the definitive evaluation. His conclusion was stark. Gary McKinnon was unfit for trial. Two other specialists agreed. Gary posed a severe suicide risk if extradited. The medical evidence was overwhelming, but political pressure from America was intense. October 16, 2012. Theresa May stood before Parliament with Gary's fate in her hands. "Mr. McKinnon is accused of serious crimes," she began. Janice held her breath. "But there is no doubt he is seriously ill." The words that followed changed everything. Extradition would give rise to such a high risk of him ending his life that it would be incompatible with his human rights. Gary was free. Wilson, Janice's husband, took the call from Gary's lawyer. "It's okay, Janice. It's over." When Janice called Gary, he sounded like a wounded animal, moaning with relief. 10 years of terror were finally ending. But freedom came with conditions. Gary could never leave England or Wales. Scotland, his birthplace, was off limits. The U.S. could still arrest him if he set foot on foreign soil. Today, Gary runs a digital marketing company in Leicester. He's returned to music, finding peace and creativity once again. New extradition laws protect future British citizens from similar ordeals. But questions remain. What did Gary really see in those Pentagon files? Were America's digital defenses truly that vulnerable? And in our connected world, who's watching the watchers? Gary McKinnon's story isn't just about one hacker's obsession. It's a wake-up call about digital security in the modern age. If a curious amateur could penetrate America's most sensitive networks, what could skilled adversaries accomplish? In 2023 alone, Americans lost over $10 billion to cyber fraud. Our data is everywhere. Our privacy is an illusion. The question isn't whether we're vulnerable, it's what we're going to do about it. One bedroom, one computer. One man's curiosity brought the world's most powerful military to its knees. In the age of digital warfare, Gary McKinnon proved the most dangerous weapon isn't technology. It's truth. And some truths, they'll move heaven and earth to hide.